Welcome to Christ Gospel Church of St. Petersburg, Florida, where Bishop Preston D.H. Leonard is our international presiding bishop and Dr. Tony Young Jr. is our pastor. We are the church where everyone is welcome, where the Bible is the guide and the Holy Ghost is the director. We are delighted you decided to join us today and pray you will be richly blessed by the praise and worship and by the Rhema word from the Lord. Please share this link with your family and friends as we prepare to go into our service. May God bless you.
Praise the Lord, Christ Gospel Church family and friends. We are so blessed that you have decided to join us again for another virtual Bible study here at Christ Gospel Church. First, we will worship the Lord in song, after which we have a dynamic lesson just for you. You don't want to miss it. Again, we say thank you for joining us.
The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Oh, come. Just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Oh, come. Just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Oh, come, just as you are before your worship the Lord and come.
welcome to another Christ Gospel Church virtual Bible study. Hi, I'm Dr. Young, and on behalf of Bishop Leonard and our entire church, we are delighted that you are here. You know, it's hard to believe that we are already in February of a brand new year. Last year brought many tests and trials, but God brought us through, and we are so grateful for that. Hey, I want to give you a special announcement. We need you to tune in with us all month long. We plan to have some different teachers to share the Word of God. It's going to be so exciting. Amen. I thought that we would start tonight, but due to some last minute changes, amen, we have to be flexible and just allow the Spirit to lead us. But amen, tonight I'm going to get us kicked off, and then for the next several weeks, we plan to bring in some great, powerful teachers to just share the Word of God with what God is doing for them. Let's go ahead and pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, Lord, for knowing whose we are and who we are. Thank you that we are the sheep of your pasture. Now, God, open our eyes, hearts, and ears that we can see, hear, and be transformed more into the image of your Son, Jesus. These and other blessings in Jesus the Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Most people around the world who have followed the Olympics have heard the name Usain Bolt, an 8-time Olympic gold medalist. Now, you may not know that Bolt is the only sprinter to win Olympic and 100 meters, 200 meters at 3 consecutive Olympics. He did it in 2008, 2012, and again in 2016. He also won 2 4x100 relay. He earned gold in those. And you know, people just feel like he was born this way, but it actually is not the case. You see, it took him less than 10 seconds for this Jamaican sprinter, Usain Bolt, to cover 100 meter distance. Did you catch that? Less than 10 seconds to run 100 meters. And in London, he stood with the gold medal again for being the fastest man in the world. Wow! Those few seconds cemented his status as the fastest man alive and placed him on the winner's podium once again. But can I share something with you? The race was not really won in a few seconds. Oh, this is going to be good tonight. But it was won by many, many hours of practice. The race that lasted a few seconds took him many weeks and months and years of workouts, weightlifting and special dieting and coaching. Yes, you see, the race was not won in the performance, but the race was won in the preparation. Some of y'all missed that. Let me say that again. The race was not won in the performance, but rather in the preparation. Brothers and sisters, if we are going to win the race in life, oh, bless his name, we must prepare. Listen to me. We must prepare to win the race. Are you preparing to just run a race because mama and them ran it? Or are you preparing to run the race to win? Brothers and sisters, if we're going to win, we can't do whatever we feel like doing. We can't eat whatever we feel like eating. We can't go wherever we want to go, but we must put first things first. That's what I'm going to talk about tonight, putting first things first. Our text tonight will be coming from Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33. Just one verse tonight. It says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you." Now, before we go into our text, let me provide some background which led up to these words of Jesus. Yes, you see, in his renowned Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is serving up an entree of spiritual teachings in Matthew chapter 6 on a platter of biblical palates. He serves a spiritual stew of various subjects, including giving to the needy and the proper way to give alms. He also spends some time teaching about prayer and how to pray and when to pray. Yes, in verse 16, Jesus teaches a great lesson on fasting for those that want to know how to fast and what to do and what not to do. Listen to Jesus, and starting in verse 16. Yes, verse 19, Jesus goes on and he teaches about money and the effects that it has on us. Then in verse 25, Jesus begins to teach about what we're going to talk about tonight, about worry and anxiety. And it is here in this section of the text where our verse that we're going to study tonight, Matthew 6, 33, comes in to play. Jesus tells us not to worry about life, not to worry about stuff. Yes, you see, the same God who created life in us can be trusted with the details of our lives. How many of you believe that we can trust God at his word? Yes, we can. Worrying about future things hinders our efforts for dealing with today's things. Yes, because of the ill and damaging effects of worry, Jesus tells us, take no thoughts about those things that God has already promised to supply. How many of you know that God can and will and wants to supply all of our needs according to his riches in glory? For those of you who like a more practical lesson, let me share a few things with you that worry can do to adversely affect your body, soul, and spirit. Worry can negatively affect our lives in many ways. Did you know that worry can damage our health? Yes, it can stress us out. We can have ulcers, blood pumping too fast, and the pressure builds up. Yes, worry can cause us to be consumed in our thoughts. We can't focus on the things at hand because we're stuck in yesterday. We're stuck into last week. Something that happened to you last year, you're still thinking about it, and life is passing you by. Worry can also negatively affect the way we treat one another. You know, we can become short and coarse and even sometimes downright ugly with our loved ones because we are worried about things. Finally, brothers and sisters, worry can reduce our ability to trust in God. Oh, it is so sweet to trust in God. Now, let's be clear. It's okay to be concerned about things. Yes, we need to be concerned about a lot of stuff. We need to be concerned about how we spend money. We need to be concerned with what we wear. We need to be concerned, make sure that we pay our bills on time. But we should never, ever worry about things. Well, you may be asking, Dr. Young, what is the difference between worrying about something and being concerned about something? What is the difference between worrying and being concerned? Well, worry can stop us from moving forward. Huh? Worry can stop us from moving forward. But concern moves us into action. Worry paralyzes us, but concern can propel us into actions. In verse 32, Jesus said, "For all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things." Some of y'all didn't quite hear what Jesus said. I'm going to say it again. He says, "For after all these things the Gentiles seek." The word Gentile is a Greek word, ethnos, which means a foreigner, a pagan, a heathen, or a non-believer. Listen to what he says. All of these things Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father, he knows what? He didn't say he knows that you want. But he says he knows that you need all these things. I need you to hear what Jesus is saying. Jesus knows, the Father knows, that there are many things that we need. And can I help you? Jesus wants to make sure that he meets all, oh, praise God, that he meets all of our needs. But when we worry, we show a lack of faith and understanding of who God is. When we worry, we are acting like foreigners in the kingdom of God. We're acting paganistic and heathenistic. We're acting like non-believers. Can I ask a question? Are there any believers out there who know that God is all right? Is there any believers who know that we can put our trust in Jesus? Now we arrive at the text at hand. Verse 33, listen to what Jesus says. He says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all of these things," listen to him again, "and some of these things, most of these things, a few," he says, "and all of these things shall be added to you." Some people misunderstand or misinterpret Jesus' message in this text. They think he's telling us to focus every single thought on him and never consider other things at all. But if we listen to the words of Jesus, Jesus said, "Seek first," which implies that there are other things that we should seek also. You see, we need to eat food. We need to seek out where we're going to eat. Some of you, just a little while ago, you had to figure out what you are going to eat for dinner. Praise his holy name. We have to seek shelter, sleep. We have to seek how we're going to raise our children, pay the bills, pay the car note. But all of these things will flow more easily if we make our relationship with Jesus our first priority. Or tell somebody sitting close to you to put first things first. If you don't have nobody sitting close to you, put it in the chat one to say, "Put first things first." And I don't have to tell you the first thing. Yes, Yes, when we put Jesus at the center of our lives, everything else will fall into place. Huh? Every day there are many different things, many different desires that are competing for first priority in our lives. Can I help you? There are some people who are trying to be number one in your life. There are some family members who want to monopolize all of your time. There are some friends. They're not satisfied with talking to you sometime. They want to be number one in your life. You see, all of these things are competing to be number one in our lives. Can I go a little deeper? Yes, yes. I know some people that Facebook is competing to be number one in our lives. There are some people who spend more time, listen to me, more time on Facebook than they spend doing their work on their job. There are some people who spend more time on YouTube than they spend talking to Almighty God. Did you know that the news stations, they want to be number one in our lives? Did you know that your job, can I tell you something that you may not, your job wants you to put them first. That's why they pay some people six figures, because they want to own your time and your talents. Money has a way to want to be number one in your life. It'll wake you up in the middle of the night. It'll make you get two or three jobs. Money is vying for that number one spot. Any of these things or people can quickly bump God out of first place if we don't actively choose to give him first place in not some area, but every area of our lives. Everything we have, everything we own here on earth, it's going to all pass away. Did you know that? One day it will all vanish. You see, people come and people go bye-bye. Yes, children, they grow up and they leave the house. And then we wonder if we're going to see them again. Did you know money come, easy go? Yes, yes, yes. Before long, all of these things that we thought we treasured are now gone. A company hires us today, and tomorrow they say, we don't need you. Here today, gone tomorrow. But when we make Jesus first in our lives, he promises to provide and supply all of our needs according to his riches in glory. Let me see if I can put some butter on the bread as I let you go tonight. Finally, Jesus ends this section of the Sermon on the Mount in verse 34. He says, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about his own things. Sufficient for the day is his own trouble. Brothers and sisters, planning for tomorrow is time well spent. We need to plan well. But worrying about tomorrow is time wasted. Yes, we need to carefully plan, because carefully planning is thinking ahead about goals, next steps, and schedules while we're trusting in God's guidance. When we do those things well, when we plan ahead, when we do proper planning, that within itself can alleviate worry. Most people who get so caught up in worrying about what may happen are poor planners. They don't plan well. We find that one of the ways that we all can alleviate worry is to have a contingency plan, have a backup plan. Don't spend all your money, but you put some money here and there. Get your two or three savings accounts. Make sure you have some stuff set up. So when life happens, you have something. This has nothing to do with you trusting God. This has everything to do with you planning and using the wisdom that God has given to you. You can't blame that on the devil, and you can't blame it on God. Dr. Young is telling you that you need to plan ahead. And let me share something else. Don't allow somebody's lack of planning to create a crisis for you. Yeah. In other words, they go out and they spend all their money on entertainment. They spend it on booze, drugs, or whatever throwaway things that they have. And then when their money is gone, guess what? They come running to you asking you for your $2. You know, this reminds me of when our five children were growing up in our home. My wife, Kathy, and I, we taught them, you know, that we don't mind helping you, but we used to tell them this: our money comes with advice. Our money comes with advice. And any one of our five kids can tell you what that means. Sometimes they'd rather be broke than to come sit down and get a lecture from mom and dad, because we're going to test them. We're going to challenge them. What's your plan? How are you going to avoid this the next time? You know, how's your savings? I mean, we give them all of these questions. In other words, we're making sure they have a bona fide plan. Because it does them or us no good to keep pouring money down a drain that ain't bringing nothing back home. I wish I got one or two parents to say, amen, that's good teaching. Now, on the other hand, worrying consumes us with fear, and it makes it difficult to trust God. You see, the worrier allows his or her plans to interfere with their relationship with God. Brothers and sisters, don't let worrying about tomorrow affect your relationship with God today. Before you leave the house, it's wise to check the weather forecast to see if it's going to rain, to see if it's going to be cold, to see if it's going to be hot. And depending on what the weather forecast says, we grab an umbrella or raincoat, or we grab a jacket or a sweater or a hat. But listen, just because I take an umbrella, it doesn't stop it from raining. Some of y'all missed it. Yes. Just because I take a jacket, it doesn't mean that it's not going to get cold. Rather, taking an umbrella protects me from getting wet. Doesn't stop the rain. Rather, it stops the rain from getting on me. Worry exposes us to the rain. Worry allows us to experience the pain of getting wet, the pressure of getting stressed out. But when we put on Jesus Christ, when we put him first, when we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then that umbrella that he provides to us, it covers us. Even when everyone else is getting soaked and wet in the rain, yes, we can rest in him. We can have peace and we can have joy. What about you today? Are you resting in him? Are you empty? Are you in light? Is there something that you are missing today? Or are you trying to chase the world? Are you trying to chase this, chase a better job, chase a better relationship, chase more money, chase better clothes, a better car? Listen, stop it. Let me give you the answer that you need. Jesus said it in Matthew 6:33. I want to end with this verse. If you seek first the kingdom of God. Oh, I hope you're getting these words. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all of these things that you need will be added unto you. I want to pray with you tonight because I feel like God has spoken to us. Yeah, I know he's spoken to me. Would you bow your heads as we pray for you and your family and your needs? Father God, we thank you for this opportunity again to come to your people. We just pray that you would bless us right now. Sanctify our hearts. God, you know the emptiness that we bear right now. Some are empty in their health account. Lord, they need a blessing. They need Jehovah Rapha to come right now and heal. In the name of Jesus, some needs Jehovah Jireh to provide for them. Oh God, do it in the name of Jesus. Help us, God, Lord, to not be distracted, but help us to focus on you first, and then you will add the things that we need. Now, Lord, it may not come when we want it. We may reach a point where we get nervous and anxious and we feel like you're just not going to do it. But God, give us the peace. Give us that quiet spirit that we can wait on it, because we know that you always keep your promises, and we'll say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, that's all the time we have for tonight. Thank you so much for joining us. Please come back Sunday mornings. We are here at 10 o'clock for our virtual services as well as Wednesday night. We got some great treats for you, some good guest singers to come and to bless us, some good guest teachers. So come back with us. We know that you will be blessed. Until the next time, be blessed.